Hello and welcome to the spa. We're back.
Hello.
For another day.
As if we wouldn't be.
I know, right?
Like, we're actually going
to
be.
Yeah, like by now everyone knows we have nothing else to do.
There is no life.
There is no life aside from randomly coming on the internet and talking to ourselves about nothing.
About a load of crap.
Yeah, about a load of crap. That's
Wendy,
us.
Please, every word is golden, dude. Come on.
What did crapulous actually mean? Can someone remind me? Like, I don't feel like it meant crap, right? Like, it's not the same. What does crapulous mean?
Actually, that's a very good question. I'm going to quickly look it up because we should know. But clearly, it goes in one part of the brain.
I'll tell you what, my hair looks a bit elf lock today.
Yeah.
But we won't be twaddling. There'll be no twaddling today. We have
it's a
focus.
T, twaddling.
Crapulous is caused by or showing the effects of alcohol. So it kind of is crap. Yeah, it kind of works actually. Yeah.
Showing the effects of alcohol, looking like you're drunk.
I hope we're all looking quite snout faced today. So.
Yeah.
Snout fair. She just
snout
did it.
Fair.
Snout fair. It's not just me. It's not just me. But I would also like to mention that I looked it up and snout is not just for pigs. Snout is for many, many different animals. So it's okay. I did not say that Louisa had a snout face. I mean, a pig face. Just let it be clear. She just had a nose face.
Maybe we don't just keep revisiting that.
Okay, sorry. If I let it go, it would have been fine. But
I've got a question to ask my lovely writer friends here today. Sure. So how is the writing going? Like, how are you going writing-wise?
Who's going to go first? I'm me. Okay. Because I noticed the big silence from Cher and Trudy.
Actually,
Cher, if you've got a story, tell it.
It's not a story. It's just that I've actually had quite a few good days of writing, and which is really good since I have a book to send to the editors next month and it's not even half finished. But hey, that's okay.
You're good at that though, rushing, getting a deadline nailed, you know.
Well, yeah, I find I actually do need a deadline. I can't kid myself and say, you know, I can just take it easy, because if I take it easy, I'm kind of just about flat on my back, really.
Lying there with the cocktail.
I've got two deadlines.
Whatever else.
I've got two deadlines pre-lockdown. And the first book's done. It's in like the rawest form humanly possible. So that will need serious manipulation to get back into line for the 4th of next month. And then I have a novella that's due the following month. And I've just started that actually. And because I write series, I have a lot, you know, like you've got so many characters just like, I need to come in here and I need to come in there. And I remember you've got brown eyes and you've got, you know, and so you're constantly keeping those balls in the air. So I'm actually really enjoying writing a novella that's just standing on its own and just like,
bit
of fun, you know, like just actually just nailing it. I was just sitting down this morning, I bashed out, you know, sort of 2,500 words and
casually just bash it out.
Yeah.
Perhaps we needed that break. Perhaps we needed some time off from those pressures that we actually put on ourselves, let's be honest. Yeah. And now we're kind of like, well, we can see the light at the end of the tunnel, hopefully. But hopefully we all are.
Do you find though that what I think of now is that being in lockdown takes some of the pressure off me to feel like I should be doing everything for some reason.
Yeah.
I feel like I just have to focus on the writing and like normally I feel like I've got 100 million things to do, but for some reason being in lockdown makes me feel like I can't do a lot of them, even though most of them are online. Like, do you know what I mean? Like, it's completely
it's giving
false.
You permission kind of
thing. It gives me permission to just do to narrow my focus. It's really
hard. But I think it has taken a while to get in that zone, don't you think?
Well, we're in week four now. So we're in week four of this, like starting. Wendy's been in it for, 45 weeks? So
17.
Yeah. A billion weeks, was it? I don't know. But I tell you what, though, I don't know if it's the same.
5 seconds.
5 seconds. Anywhere else. But I went shopping yesterday.
Yeah.
And I had been shopping one other time in the lockdown, and it was maybe 2 weeks ago, something like that, week and a half ago. And that the week and a half ago when I went was really stressful, and everyone around me was really stressed.
Yes.
And people were frowny, and there was no interaction. Everyone was like trying to stay in their little imaginary bubble. Yep. Whereas when I went yesterday, it was a lot more relaxed. People were kind of just a little bit less tense. I mean, there was all this, everything was, you know, everyone was still keeping away from each other and the dude, you know, everyone with masks and gloves and all that sort of stuff, but it wasn't so stressed. It was all, and it's either
we're adapting. People are pretty adaptable.
Or people feeling like maybe in New Zealand that we've got fewer numbers, so it's not.
I don't know. How's your writing going though? Are you getting
my writing? Well, I didn't, because, okay, so I have Zoe in the house and school started yesterday officially.
Woof, for school.
So yesterday was a bit of a funny day. I didn't get any writing done, but I have been doing a decent amount. But I'm like these guys in that I have a deadline next week. And I was supposed to be finished this stupid book that I'm currently writing. My delight.
Hang on.
The stupid book.
What would Brooke say about my delightful
book that I'm loving writing.
If you're her fans, she loves every book. Yeah. She's just downloading a little bit. She doesn't actually mean it.
No, I don't mean it. I love this book. It's due to the editor next week. And in my head, I was going to finish it, have a break, and then go back to edit it. And it's taken me so long to get, like, I'm still not finished. I've got like maybe another, well, I'm hoping between 5,000 and 10,000 to go.
Oh, look, I'll write two. She can write one. Oh, you sweet. Write two. We'll just whack that in there.
I'm totally on board. I'll send it to you. Go.
We'll just whack that out.
But it's just annoying. Like, you know, I was fully expecting I should have been finished this book by the beginning of April, and I'm not.
Yeah, but come on, dude. How many pandemics have you lived through?
I've been having some good times with Zoe, and we've been having, I don't know, doing stuff.
It's a strange time, you know. Like,
it's a very strange time.
I think, like, I should have more time. Because I'm not going out and I'm not spending time with people. You know, my husband's home and he's been great. If you need to work, go and work, rah, rah, rah. And I'm like, not so much. You know? You put that jug on, mate. Make me a coffee.
I'm drinking way more tea and coffee than I've ever done in my life.
Oh, and food.
Eating. Oh, the eating.
Constant eating, right?
Yeah. Well, thinking about eating. Like planning it.
Yeah.
Well, what should we have for breakfast, lunch, and dinner?
That's it. Exactly. So we're going to do the who do you want people.
So talking of eating, so we're at our imaginary dinner party, our ideal dinner party, and I would like to put a caveat on this that we're not picking like recently or not that recently past beloved, you know, loved ones. We're talking famous dead people. If you could pick two to come to your dinner party, who would they be and why? Trudy! Da-da-da.
Okay, well, do you know what? I'm just saying the two people that popped into my head first, and I'm sure there's a million other really fascinating, interesting people, but these are just the two that I've always wanted to meet and didn't. And the first one is Roald Dahl, because I love his writing. I loved his kids' stories, and I love his adult stories. One of my favourite short stories of all time is Lamb to the Slaughter. And if you have never read it, go and read it, because it's hilarious. And it's not hilarious in a funny, cheerful way. It's hilarious in a dark, twisted way.
It sounds like you.
Totally. And I don't know. I don't know what he was like. I've heard some stories about he wasn't the most, like, anyway. But
who's your second?
My second one is Anne McCaffrey. Because I loved her books too.
The Dragon Riders of Pern.
The Dragon Riders of Pern. And that was, honestly, that was my favourite books growing up. And I've just been reading, you know, some of them again. And they're still just as good. I mean, they were written, I guess, in the 70s. I'm not really 100% certain. And 70s, 80s. And she just rocks. Like, honestly, she was cool. And she lived on a horse farm in Ireland or something and was like reclusive, and she sounds really grumpy. You know those older grumpy women, which I'm kind of attracted to that concept.
Do you know that could be because you could be like that?
I'm going to be that grumpy old lady.
You're going to move into that now. Cher, who are you got?
See Trudy being grumpy.
Go, Cher, who are you got?
Well, mine are kind of like chalk and cheese. I picked Mother Teresa.
Oh, wow.
And Elvis Presley.
Oh, such awesome picks. And do you know what? I bet they'd get on quite well.
Well, Mother Teresa got on well with everybody, didn't she, really? Yeah. But I mean, her take on the world and her philosophies, I think we could all just take an
I knew people would have good ones, and I just had random.
And Trudy
ones.
Wants to steal everyone's now. Go, Shane.
Go. Sorry. Shit. No. Well, Cheryl has to say why Elvis Presley.
Yeah. Why Elvis?
And Elvis Presley, because I just found his life quite fascinating. Sad, tragic, but yeah. Also, I mean, moments of brilliance. And
oh my God, he was such a hottie. You have to get him when he was a hottie, right?
He was a hottie. And he shared that, you know, like, you know, he used to entertain the troops and things like that. And, yeah, no.
And he could have a bit of a sing-song at your dinner party. So that would be pretty awesome. There you go.
Have you seen, there's this concert that he gives, and he's like in the middle of, I think it's like a plus sign, and he just, when he was young, and I, because when I always sort of knew him when he was older, and he was, that I knew him.
Post peanut butter days is not so good. Post
10 roast chickens a day.
And he could have taught Mother Teresa.
Okay, moving on now.
No, but he had the most, I want to finish my story. Because he was, you know, you watch him in action, and he was just so graceful, and he just that hip movement he did, and oh my God, like, honestly, yeah, you just, anyway,
there's,
so get
there's a reason
young,
that sure, all the women sure. were fainting and screaming. Exactly.
Totally, yeah, totally.
Okay,
a reason.
So my two are, so remembering, not that anybody will ever remember, so my live dinner party guests were Cher and Emma Thompson. Yeah. And so for my not alive dinner party guests, because we're at the same dinner, so Alan Rickman is just, ooh, I love Alan Rickman.
He's brilliant. Love him.
And he could just sit there and read stuff.
Yeah.
Like, that would be really cool. And he's good mates with Emma. So, like, that would be
perfect grouping.
That would be a really cool thing.
Good grouping.
And then it would be Jane Austen, because I just.
She took my one.
I was going to say, I thought someone else.
It was, but she's taken it.
And so they could all talk
about, like, Emily Bronte
writing and stuff like that. And then. Yeah, and then Cher could, like, be the background music kind of thing. Like, not that she wouldn't
our Cher, but yeah, the other one.
No. Cher. Yeah. Sunny's Cher. Yeah. All right, Wendy, you go.
All right. Okay, so now that Jane Austen's been taken.
Sorry.
She can come to yours as well.
No, well, you know, I just.
Have them on different days.
I'm a little
so
bit pissed. I'm not going to lie.
Sorry.
So maybe Barbara Cartland.
Oh my god, she'd have some stories.
She would have some stories.
And I think she'd get on really well with Winston Churchill.
I think she would too.
Oh, who invited Winston?
Me.
Oh, you invited Winston. Yeah, okay.
Other person. So I would probably have both of them because.
And Queen. I bet the Queen would love Winston to be there.
Well, she's going to be there, but also Will Smith. So the whole, if you think of that dynamic.
Yeah, hang on, the Queen was mine.
Yeah, but I'm just saying, if we're having
a joint dinner,
could you imagine Will Smith schmoozing with Barbara Cartland?
Oh no, she would not like that.
She'd love it.
Did you not see her on that interview with Joan Collins?
Yeah.
Oh, no, not Joan Collins, Jessie Collins.
Really? I wonder if she told her
her stuff was disgusting.
I wonder
if she did say that. We need to find that on YouTube. If I can find the guys,
I'll put it in the comments.
Who's that English guy that always interviews used to interview all the people?
Oh, the dude with the sandy hair. I know who he's about.
Parkinson.
Yeah.
He had her on with Jackie Collins, Barbara Cartland, Jackie Collins. It was
Oh my gosh. I have to YouTube that one immediately.
Yeah.
Do it, people.
Oh no. Hilarious.
Right. So we're going to round this little
talk fest up with a joke, Cher?
No, we don't have time for a joke.
Two second joke.
One joke.
Come on.
I'm reading a book about anti-gravity. It's impossible to put down.
Very good.
Okay,
everyone.
Be well. Bye.